Come fly with me, let's fly away. If you can use some exotic booze, there's a bar in the far Bombay. Come fly with me, let's fly.
Every year, more and more Americans are traveling, both domestically and internationally. Sometimes they travel as part of a vacation. Sometimes they travel for business. More and more, people are traveling as part of volunteer programs to help other people. And there's some interesting new research on the benefits of travel. The Global Coalition on Aging found that after a vacation during which people traveled, they felt their health was better, their energy, productive, and focus had improved, and they were happier. Apparently, traveling on vacation can also increase your lifespan. The Framingham Heart Study looked at 12,000 men who were at risk for heart disease and found that the men who did not take an annual vacation had a 32% greater risk of death.
In the interest of full disclosure, I think I must tell you that the information from the Framingham study about the importance of a vacation was brought to my attention by my wife, along with an extraordinary collection of travel brochures. No matter why you're traveling, it's important to protect your health and your well-being, and that goes for the people you are traveling with. It's not difficult to do it if you pay attention. The first thing you want to do is find out what is going on at the place you are going to in terms of health and personal safety. And a good place to start is the website for the Centers for Disease Control, the CDC.
The Center for Disease Control is an agency of our federal government. Its job is to protect Americans from threats to our health and safety. And that danger can originate in other countries or in the U.S. It might be a disease that started at home or abroad. It could be chronic or acute, curable or preventable, human error or a deliberate attack. The job of the CDC is to fight disease and support communities and citizens to do the same. It's an outstanding source of information, and I continually use it to keep informed on medical issues. Just log on to cdc.gov/travel. A page comes up, and you select the place you are planning to visit. The site will tell you if you need any vaccinations, and if so, which ones. Remember that some vaccinations will need 6 weeks to be effective, so the earlier you get them, the better.
A study by the Infectious Disease Society of America found that over half the international travelers did not have the proper vaccination for measles or hepatitis A. It's also a good idea to get in touch with the State Department at travel.state.gov. They'll give you a list of areas they're concerned about.
They also have something called the Smart Traveler Program, or STEP, S-T-E-P. It's free. Well, free in the sense that they're not asking you for money, because you've already paid for it with your federal taxes, so use it. It enrolls your trip with the nearest U.S. embassy or consulate in the country you're going to. If anything important comes up about safety conditions in that country, they'll send you up-to-date information.
STEP can also help the U.S. Embassy get in touch with you in the event of emergency, like a civil unrest or a natural disaster. And it can help your family back home get in touch with you directly in case there's an emergency there, like when my brother-in-law tried to cash my winning lottery ticket.
In general, it's an excellent service, but I wouldn't recommend it to my friends in the Federal Witness Protection Program. Trust me, it's not for you guys. Don't forget about your medical insurance. Most plans have limited coverage outside the U.S. In theory, Medicare will cover inpatient hospital care, ambulance services, and dialysis in foreign hospitals. If the hospital is closer than the nearest U.S. medical facility.
I preface that information with the phrase, in theory, because when you're dealing with the federal government, you actually never know what's going to happen. What I suggest is you contact your insurance agent, see what they have to say, then make them say it in writing. Consider insurance for trip cancellation, for medical emergencies, and something to cover your untimely demise. American brand names. It's unusual for a foreign country to have the same name for a medication as we have in the United States.
I take a medication to reduce my blood pressure. In the United States, it's called Quinapril or Acupril. In Switzerland, it's called Quilarium or Acupro. In Italy, it's called Grappa. Names are similar, but different enough to confuse your drugstore computer. You should always have a list of all your medications with you all the time, the amounts you take and what days you take them, and a list of your doctors. You should leave that at home and you should take it with you. You should share that information with the people you travel with and make sure it's always available. I keep mine on my cell phone.
Think about what you will be doing on your trip. Climbing to the top of a Maya pyramid? Walking through the streets of a medieval town? About 2 months before a trip, it's a good idea to start training. A little cardiovascular stuff on a treadmill. Some balance exercises. Stretching.
And don't laugh about getting ready for your deck chair. If you're going to spend 2 or 3 hours just stretched out and not moving, it's a good idea to have on some compression socks. They will help your blood flow properly. And if you're going to use any special equipment on the trip, get accustomed to how it works before you leave.
For years, I believed that the worst food that confronted me was the stuff cooked by Sergeant Hazelwood during my time in the U.S. Army. Then I started encountering airline food, assuming food is the right word. So let me say this about that. Airport security will not allow you to bring on more than about 3 ounces of liquid. But once you clear through the screening area, you can buy whatever foods and drinks you want and bring them on board. You are not compelled to eat the food presented by the airline. In fact, in a number of states, eating airline food is considered to be cruel and unusual punishment under the U.S. Constitution.
Fat-filled foods can have an almost immediate effect, restricting your blood flow. And sitting for hours in the same seat in a pressurized cabin can make it even worse. Swollen feet is the most common response, but all that sitting can result in deep vein thrombosis. A blood clot forms inside your body. It breaks free, enlarges in your brain or your lungs or your heart. It's also important to avoid alcohol and sugary soft drinks. Both will increase the effect of the jet lag.
I'm ready when you're ready.
Are you sure?
Yes.
Okay.
I think.
During my years of traveling and reporting, one of the things I discovered was that from time to time, no matter how much I enjoyed a food, my body had an abnormal immune response, commonly known as a food allergy. And in fact, whether you travel a lot or not, it's important to understand the problem. One of the reports I read in connection with this program came from the Yale School of Medicine and dealt with reactions to specific foods and a test known as the ALCAT test. The ALCAT test was developed by a group of scientists at a company headquartered in South Florida. Now, I could have read the research and sent a film crew and a producer to check it out, but I'm not that kind of guy. If someone has to leave the gray, cold winter weather and fly all the way to warm, sunny Florida, it's my job to make that sacrifice. So I came here to see Roger Deutsch, who runs the company.
That's generic. An allergy is a very acute and dramatic reaction to a food like peanut or crustacean. We eat it, we get hives, or the throat closes up immediately. That's an allergy. You don't really need a test for that. An intolerance is something a bit more nuanced. It could be that we don't have the enzyme to break down the sugar in milk, lactase, and so the milk sugar lactose causes irritation in the gut if we consume it. The sensitivity is something much more broad and definitely much more nuanced. It differs from an allergy primarily in that the symptom onset is delayed. It could be hours or even a couple of days before the symptoms occur. And the symptoms are not nearly as dramatic.
When I was a kid, I thought I was allergic to my family's cooking. And now I find out I'm only intolerant. How embarrassing.
One of the stranger things I discovered when I was talking to Roger is that for some people, exercise can cause a reaction to a specific food. Accordingly, not eating for a few hours before you exercise could be a good idea. There's also something called cross-reactivity.
Cross-reactivity is when a person reacts to two different substances that share some molecular similarities. So for example, people who have sensitivities to latex may also have sensitivities to kiwi or bananas. People who have sensitivity to birch tree pollen may have allergies to apple. So they can eat apples most of the year, but when the birch trees are pollinating, it's too much of a load in their system, and then they have an immunological response.
Also, if you find that watching the nightly news and finding out what our governments are doing with our tax money causes a rapid increase in your pulse rate, a sudden drop in your blood pressure, dizziness, and nausea, could be cross-reactivity. Check with your doctor.
Your body's response to a food it can't tolerate can be quite simple, like a rash, or as complex as cutting off your breathing. And in some cases, it can actually kill you. And very often, it's a response to the simplest foods, like milk or shellfish or eggs or my stepmother's cooking. Oh, I mentioned that already, didn't I?
The symptoms vary from person to person, as does the amount of food needed to trigger a reaction. Parts of the body's immune system binds to a group of food molecules and causes the release of inflammatory chemicals. In the United States, it is estimated that each year, up to 12 million people have reactions to food that result in over 30,000 emergency room visits.
The more I researched the problem, the more I came across the phrase specific foods. But which specific foods? I wanted to know about the dangers way in advance of the problem.
Here lies Burt, who relished each dish. Discovered too late, allergic to fish.
Every fruit or vegetable contains poisons to protect itself from pests. Nowadays, we eat foods from all over the world, every different time of year, and they're grown under different conditions. And they're also grown under conditions where they don't contain all the other nutrients that they would if they were grown, let's say, before the advent of industrial agriculture. And that means that our system gets less nourishment. So we have sort of a double whammy. We have foods we're not used to, or maybe are adulterated, and we have less of a capacity to detoxify them. So we might have an adverse response to those foods. If it passes through the liver and the toxins are not taken out, then the innate immune system gets called into action.
You may not have adequate amounts of some enzymes needed to digest certain foods. That's why many people have problems with milk. Bacteria in spoiled fish can trigger reactions. Some people have a problem with gluten in bread, pasta, and other foods containing wheat, barley, or rye. Certain food additives can cause reactions. My wife and my youngest son are both sensitive to MSG. As soon as we walk into our local Chinese restaurant, the chef recognizes and says, "No MSG!" Good man. In response to the problem, some countries require food producers to clearly inform consumers of their products' major allergens that might be contained in the food, or byproducts of major allergens. Some countries also require companies to warn consumers when food has been prepared near certain allergens that have been known to cause severe reactions. The European Union went even further and requires food businesses to provide allergy information on food sold unpackaged in delicatessens, bakeries, and fast food shops. Many people believe that a food allergy is just a dislike of a certain food. They don't realize that it can be a serious medical condition. Okay, in the interest of self-preservation, I have decided to have myself tested.
So Mr. Burt, you just come on in and take a seat. Okay. We're going to draw your blood.
Okay.
If it works, great. If not, I hope to be remembered as having made an outstanding contribution to the history of television.
So we are done.
No lollipop.
I don't want to feel guilty if that comes in your test results and then you're going to blame me. So we enter your information and our labs. It's a proprietary system that we have. Really? I have a sample from an in-house draw that we have to process for today. We start with the first step, that is reading your white blood cells and your granulocytes.
Bert, the first thing we do with your blood is we run what we call a pre-analysis. And we want to see what your cellular composition is. We're really only interested in the white blood cells. We want to get the red blood cells out of the way because they're not involved in an immune reaction.
Okay, let me make sure I'm getting this right. You're taking my blood and you're measuring the white blood cells, the red blood cells, and the ones that are important are the white blood cells.
You got it.
So what happens next?
Next, your blood is placed inside a special tube that contains a substance which will actually grab the red cells, and when we centrifuge those, the red blood cells will then separate themselves from the white blood cells.
So what's happening here?
So now this machine is transferring your sample into all these individual 55 wells. The wells contain test substances, extracts of apple, beef, corn, celery, cucumber, et cetera, or the food additives. Your sample is going to intermingle with the test substances for a period of time at room temperature. In this laboratory, we do a number of different serology tests, and we're looking in the blood for certain markers that go along with our evaluation of gastrointestinal diseases. So your blood cells have had a chance to interact with all the different test reagents, and now we're going to read those reactions. So this machine will inject a liquid into each well, and then a reaction takes place there, which helps in the reading. And you'll see in a moment the appearance of the histogram, or the size distribution curve. Here's a control well. That's what your blood looks like just coming off the street. Nothing additional is added to it in terms of a test reagent. What it's going to tell us when we do a comparison is whether or not the exposure to the substance has caused the cells to react. And the reaction will be seen by a shift in the size. The cells may swell up to try and neutralize the particle that they think is dangerous. In the process, it may go a little bit further, and the cells are actually destroyed.
So what's happening in here?
So here's where we prepare the test substances. So of course, if we're starting with foods, we actually go to the market, buy the foods, put them in the lyophilizer, freeze dry them so that they're stable for a long time. Then we suspend them in liquid. And then when we put the test reagents into the wells, we know that we're putting in a substance that we understand its potency.
So you've gone to the market, you bought all of this stuff, you've prepared
it here,
and then that's what's going in to mix with my white blood corpuscles to see what's happening.
Exactly. So here's where the liquid test reagent gets put into cassette. So they draw the different substances and put them in a different substance into each well. And after they're dried, this is where your blood sample goes into the cassette.
So there were like 50 different things that my blood was tested against, and there'd be a chart like this for each one of them.
Exactly.
Okay.
And they mean red is a strong reaction. Orange is also a pretty moderate reaction. Yellow is in an intermediate range, and depending upon the context, may have to try and avoid those also, as you can. And green foods you can eat freely, and one of our nutritionists is going to go over that with you.
So here we're talking about sensitivities. And the thing that you also keep in mind is the immune system is a dynamic, a changing system of the body. Everything that's reactive here, it's not necessarily the case that you'll need to avoid them forever.
Great. Right? So we would go 2 days?
Well, I'm going to suggest a little longer than that.
Okay.
So I like to start with the good news first. So you have quite a variety. So I would invite you to take a look at these. Let's make sure that you enjoy a lot of these.
I love onions and shallots.
Great.
White potatoes are fine. Endive is one of my favorite foods. Okay.
So you have a nice variety of vegetables that you enjoy, and of course we would suggest that you also branch out and maybe have the others as well as not reactive to encourage a variety of foods, encourage a variety of nutrients into your body. Okay, so we see that you had a severe reaction to the things that are in the red column here. Those we would suggest that you avoid them for 6 months or more.
6 months.
6 months or more would be best. So looking at this, I always like to ask, what foods are significant for you in this list?
Chicken, coffee.
Are you a coffee drinker daily? Yeah, I know a lot of people are. That's a tough one.
Three or four espressos a day.
Mm-hmm. That's a tough one. And normally I would suggest that we replace that caffeine with black tea, but you also had a reaction to that. So we might need to talk about how we incorporate that suggestion. You might want to do one thing at a time here. Now the moderate list, the recommendation here would be a 3 months or more avoidance. One thing I always like to point out is olive.
Right.
You didn't mention olive, but remember olive oil. So that oil would be best that you replace that for the 3 months or more. And here are some oils that you could use: almond oil, coconut oil, safflower oil, walnut oil. You know, so you have a nice handful of sesame oil. You have a nice handful of oils that you could use that, to replace that sunflower oil.
I'm going to start on this, and then I will come back in 6 months, and we will reevaluate. But the key is, of course, my paying attention to what's going on in my body.
Okay. I'm going to try and follow these instructions and will report back how I feel. If you don't hear from me by the end of the week, send out the dogs.
I know this program has had a lot of detailed information that might be hard to remember, so I put it all on the website, burtwolf.com. For Travels and Traditions, I'm Burt Wolf.
But wait, there's more.
Whenever we edit one of our programs, we always end up with more good material than we can fit in. Interviews, stories, recipes. So we decided to put them on our website, burtwolf.com.